Okay, so in this presentation, I just want to talk a little bit about how we actually format a figure for a scientific paper. So when you do your lab report and you have to make goldfish graphs, this is how you're going to format them in order to get all your points, okay? So the first thing, and we sort of discussed this a little bit, is just to think about presenting your data. So you need to look at the main points. What are you trying to get across when you're looking at your data? What's your main point, and what's the best way to communicate that to your reader? The next thing you want to do is pick a graph or table that best illustrates these points. Okay? Note there's kind of a little oddity that in science you have figures and tables. So everything fits into those two categories. So a table is pretty much what you think of as a table, and a figure includes everything else. So it can be all graphs, plus any other diagram, picture, or chart, anything that's not a table, basically. All right? Figures and tables should both be self-explanatory. So a lot of times when you're reading scientific literature, you're not reading them, you know, in perfect order. You're kind of skipping around, so you might flip through and look at the figures and see what somebody's data are. So you want those figures and tables to be very, to have all the information in there so that somebody can understand them, okay? And along with today's video and the PowerPoint, always remember to check your lab manual guide to writing papers in the biological sciences. So in the appendix, it has lots of useful information. It has some more examples. It has some examples of things not to do. So make sure you use that to double check yourself. All right. So this is basically just a scatter plot. And I think we mentioned before that this is a good first step with your data, especially, let's say, later on in the semester when you're doing your independent projects. You might not exactly know, you know, what relationship your data might have or what you're going to make of your results. So sometimes just looking at a scatter plot helps you figure out and look at your data, make sure there's no mistakes, make sure, you know, look at the various overall relationships. But you usually, there's a few exceptions, but you're usually not going to present a scatter plot. So most of the time we're going to present some other figure in which we've worked with the data a little bit more. Okay? And I'm just going to show this right now. We're not going to use bar graphs right away, but we will use them later on in the semester. So bar graphs are used when you're comparing groups. So in this case, it's comparing groups of organisms. So these are all marine organisms. And basically, they're comparing TMAO content. That should sound familiar. Remember, that's one of those compounds that sharks use to osmoregulate or help osmoregulate. And in this case, it's comparing groups, right? You may also see this a lot if you're comparing, you know, a treatment to a control or treatment A to treatment B. Anytime you're looking at different groups, you can use a bar graph. But we're actually going to start out by looking at XY graphs. So on XY graphs, and you've probably seen this before maybe in high school, the x-axis is the independent variable. So it doesn't depend on the other variables, and it's the thing you're allowing to change, okay? I always remember this because it's really obvious to me that whenever you have a graph with time, time just goes in the x-axis. I sort of just automatically know that without thinking about it. And time has to be independent, okay? So time is always an independent variable, so therefore, all your independent variables, no matter what they may be, are going to be on your x-axis. The y-axis is the dependent or response variable. So it's what's changing over time in this case, the thing that changes in response to the x parameter. Okay. So if we're looking at figures, right? When you use Excel or maybe another graphing program, you may wind up with something like this when it first starts out. Okay, so when first constructed, figures often look something like this. So what kinds of things are wrong with this figure? So again, kind of pause it for a second and see how many things you can jot down that you would change on this initial figure. Okay, So let's look. So no titles on figures. So that's one thing. Again, science might be a little different from other areas. So if your graphing program wants to put a title in, go ahead and delete it. Always or almost always, you want to include a line. So a line just visually helps us see what the overall trend is. Okay, so in 105, we're just going to kind of connect the points. When you get to cells and we're looking at equations, you're actually going to do sort of a line of best fit. You also note that we have no idea looking at this graph what our axes are. So these must be labeled, and they're always labeled using a format that has the label and then the unit in parentheses. So if it's, you know, let's say this is weight, it would be weight in grams. Okay? And then whatever this axis would be, it would be the title, and then in parentheses, whatever unit you're using. Okay? The other thing this particular graph points out is if we're just looking at one data set, you don't want this little data key off to the side. And a lot of programs will call this a legend. I like to refer to it as a data key. It's what tells you what your symbols mean. For one group of symbols, you don't need it. So delete it if you're just looking at one group. Okay, because it just kind of makes it busier and gets in the way. Okay. The other thing I'll just point out that you might have noticed is we're also going to put a descriptive figure legend on the bottom. So that's where we're going to give the reader any additional information they need to interpret the graph. Okay, so if we make some of these changes, so we've now put in our labels, and okay, it was fish weight, grams, and time, it turned out, and the time is in months. Notice that on the time axis, the vast majority of time, you're just going to start at the beginning of your experiment and move forward, either hours or months, days, minutes. You're not going to label it with like the exact date. There are exceptions to that, but most of the time, you're just counting forward, as it were. Okay, they've got their graph, they've got a line. So this is what your figure should look like. There's no figure legend yet, but we're going to work on that in a minute. For one data set, right? But what happens if you have multiple data sets? So okay, we can start putting in additional lines if we're comparing them, and now we need our data key back in there because we need to tell the reader what the red, green, and purplish, magenta line is. Okay, so this form of legend is useful to distinguish multiple data sets. Okay. So let's start thinking, remember in our previous video, we were talking about averages not giving you enough information. So we want to start putting in some information about variability. All right, so we're going to do that by including error bars on our data. All right, so you're going to basically have the program put in error bars that are giving you some information about the variability. All right, remember that we're going to use standard error. Okay, so we're not going to use standard deviation, we're going to use standard error. And when you do this, then you must tell the reader that you're using standard error. Because they don't know. Maybe, you know, if they just see error bars, they have no idea what type of error bar it is. It could be standard deviation, it could be the range, and those things are different, so you need to make sure you tell the reader, okay? All right, so now we have error bars that indicate the standard error, and also it's a good idea to tell the reader how many replicates. So this is the standard error for three fish, for instance. Okay. All right, now let's talk about the descriptive legends. A lot of students find these the most difficult things to write, and they do take a little bit of practice. I also suggest starting to pay more attention to other figures you see. So think about how they're worded, what information they contain, and maybe some different ways that they do things. So we'll show you a couple at the end of this presentation. So let's start working on what a figure legend should contain, okay? Notice here it's saying that a descriptive legend must be at the bottom for a figure, and on a table, you're actually gonna put it up top. So figure, it's always gonna be figure one, and then your descriptive legend. Table will go up top, and it'll say table one, and then a descriptive legend, okay? Okay, so here are some advice. So must include a figure number that matches the order in which the figure is mentioned in the text. So this is a big one. This is where your editing comes into play. I suspect a lot of students make the graphs and then they write the paper and they forget that they've mentioned their figures out of order. So you never want to start with figure three and then go back to figure one. You always want to make sure that the order you mention them in the text is the same order that you're going to show the figures. So figure one is the first one you mentioned, figure two is the second one, etc. All right, must provide enough information so that the figure can stand alone without reference to the text of the paper. Must reveal what experiment is being illustrated. Okay, so in this case, maybe it's just growth rate. All right, here's a big one, so pet peeves. It should not contain lead-in words. So do not say, this graph shows. All right, again, science really is gonna be as concise as possible. And you know you're looking at a graph, so you don't need the first phrase to say, this graph shows, okay? If you find this difficult, here's my tip. Write out your sentence with this graph shows, right, so that you can sort of think about what your next wording is gonna be, and then just delete it. The vast majority of time, you can just delete this graph shows and use the rest of your sentence. So that first sentence in a figure legend is often more just a phrase, and that in this case is okay, all right? So don't use lead-in words. It should include both common and scientific names of the experimental organism used. So be very, again, we wanna make sure the reader knows exactly what organism you're using, right? And never discuss the results shown in the figure and the legend. So what this means is you're not doing any analysis here, or you're letting the reader come to their own conclusions, in other words. You're not telling them what you've already decided about the figure. You're just presenting the results and letting them sort of look at it and decide what's going on. Okay, so let's work on a figure. So let's practice evolving a proper figure legend. So imagine this is a graph for one fish, okay? So the first thing we want to do is start to put in sort of an initial figure legend. And the first time students do this, they might wind up with something like this. So it might just say, this graph shows the rate of growth versus time for a goldfish, right? All right, so we've already talked about some of this. So we know we've got to get rid of this graph shows. And the other thing we don't want to do is we don't want to use versus. So don't say just X versus Y, all right? That's what, like, if, you know, if you're writing in your notebook, you can say it, but we want to be a little bit more sophisticated. So we're not going to just say growth versus time, okay? So instead, what we want to look at is just call it growth rate. So growth rate for a goldfish, so here's the common name, Crassus aratus is your scientific name. Notice again, genus is capitalized, it's in italics. Maintained on tetra fish food for 13 months and 600 ml of dechlorinated tap water at 18 degrees C, okay? So notice this legend now is giving you enough information that you understand what the experiment is, right? You can look at the graph and you know what the parameters were, and now you're looking at, okay, well, how long did this go on? What were they doing? What was the temperature? And you understand the experiment, okay? Right. Now, for your purposes, remember we're using, I forget, that was 10 fish. I think some of the groups had 8 fish, okay? So we're actually doing our averages with our error bars. So we need to make a few adjustments. So you need to make sure you state that it's the mean growth rate at some point. Again, goldfish, crassus, serratus, same sentence about previous treatment. And then notice we've got to add in bars represent standard error of the mean for 3 fish. Okay, and there's a couple different ways you can do this, but you must tell me what the bars represent. If you do not tell me what the bars represent, you will get points deducted. So don't do that. Make a note to yourself that you always have to tell me what the error bars mean. Okay? All right. So let's look at a few examples now. So these are examples that we're taking from real scientific journals. So let's see how they did. And I'm going to tell you right off the bat that there might be one or two things that they do differently than we just went over. So you're going to follow our lead because we want to really use the most precise figure legends that we can. All right, so this is our bar graph from previously. Note now the figure legends. So TMAO content in muscles of marine animals from shallow habitats and bathyal and abyssal. So this is just referring to the depth trawl site. Okay, so notice it's just a first sentence. There's no verses. It doesn't say this graph shows. It just jumps right in, tells you what the graph is. All right, error bars indicate standard deviation. Okay, so that's good. That's what we said. And then it's telling you a little bit something about the statistics. When you take a statistics class, you might actually look at your data in more detail. We're not going to worry about this. And then the other thing it does is it sort of refers you to some other information that's in the paper. Okay? Notice it's got a data key that's up here, right, just like we were talking about, and then you've got your axes titles are written out. Right? So that's one graph. Oh, what doesn't this one do? So it doesn't always give you all of the names, the common names, and the scientific names. So it's telling you group names, and it actually kind of switches. So it goes from shrimp, and then it's giving you more details about some of them. Okay. And then here we have, so this is looking at percent survival. So percent survival doesn't actually have a unit, since it's a percent, over time. So survival rate, and in parentheses, it tells you what it's looking at, percent survival, of spiny dogfish, okay, it should say Squalus acanthius, in parentheses, exposed to different silver concentrations. And now, instead of using a data key, it's actually going to tell you in the figure legend what each of the symbols mean. So dotted line, right, gray circles, black circles. So it's using that down in your figure legend. You can do it either way. It's often easier just to include a data key, but that's up to you. It's another way to do it. All right, here's another graph, very similar. This time they're looking at urea excretion over time. And so you've got urea excretion of spiny dogfish exposed to different silver concentrations. Again, it's telling you what each of your symbols are. And now, since we're looking at groups of them, it is telling you that the mean values are plus and minus the standard error of the mean. So slightly different wording, but same idea. All right. And then there's one more. Okay. And then this graph, this is a case where it actually uses one figure legend for two graphs. All right. We're going to keep ours separate for the time being. But again, changes in mean fasted weight, so it just jumps right in. So it's telling you what the graph is. It's telling you something about the organism. Now, in this case, it gave you the scientific name, but it didn't give you the common name. So remember, we want both. All right. Figures indicate sample sizes. Error bars indicate standard error of means. So in this case, there's different number of replicates for various points. So they're telling you on the figure itself, and then the error bars are showing standard errors in the mean.
All right, and in this case, because the lines were close together, they chose to only show either the upper or lower. Most times you're gonna show both. Okay. All right, so those are some hints on how to format your graphs. So what you're gonna do, that'll work, is, so next week your baby graphs are due. And then we're gonna actually work on in class, so in lab, you're gonna start out lab on the 26th and we're gonna do vertebrate development, okay? But then the second half of lab, we're gonna switch and we're going to look at Excel and we're gonna do some graphing and you'll have a chance to actually graph your goldfish data, okay? And when you do this, I want you to think back to this video, right? And think about all the different parts that you're going to need to make good figures, okay? And so you're going to turn those in either that day, either Thursday, or the next day on Friday. And we're going to go ahead and grade them and hand them back. And then you're going to make corrections as indicated. Sorry. And then you're going to turn in the corrected graphs as a part of your lab report. Okay, so hopefully by doing them sort of separately, we're really focusing on how to do the graphs and we're going to concentrate on getting good format. And then when you turn them in on your lab report, you should get full credit because you've already had them corrected. That's the goal anyway. Okay, the lab report for the goldfish is going to be due on Friday, April 3rd. So you can start working on it if you want. The guidelines are posted on GaucherLearn. So if you want to look ahead, you can see what sections. We're going to focus on your results and discussion for this particular lab report. So part of it's going to be doing the graphs and then discussing the data and your analysis. So the guidelines are on GaucherLearn, so you can start looking at that, and then that's the sequence of events. And so hopefully by the week after spring break, you'll be all caught up from the lab you missed due to snow. All right, so enjoy your spring break, and I'll see you on the 26th.